University of New York, where he has taught for almost three decades. He graduated summa cum laude and first in his physics class at Harvard in 1968, received his PhD in physics from UC Berkeley in 1972, and in addition to City University of New York, has taught at Harvard and Princeton as well. Dr. Kaku is the author of several international bestsellers, including his latest book, Physics of the Future, How Science Will Shape Human Destiny and Our Daily Lives by the Year 2100. He's also a well-traveled and sought-after voice in world media, frequently featured in international radio, television, film, and print. From Nightline to the BBC, Science Channel to PBS, Time Magazine and the Wall Street Journal, to New Scientist, Astronomy Magazine, and the London Times. Dr. Kaku has even been featured in an Emmy-nominated full-length feature film, Me and Isaac Newton. Dr. Kaku has been everywhere, past, present, and future. And now he's in Salt Lake City with us. Please give a warm welcome to Dr. Michio Kaku.
Such a great introduction. I can't wait to hear the speaker myself. Sometimes, you know, these accolades can backfire. Recently, New York Magazine said that I would be chosen as one of the 100 smartest people in New York City. So I thought, wow, what a great honor. But to be fair, in all honesty, I have to admit that Madonna also made that same list. And next year, I understand that Lady Gaga is going to push me off the list entirely. Such is fame. Well, today I'm going to talk about the impact of high technology on society in the future. In the next 20 years, in fact. Now, prediction is very difficult and dangerous. Let me quote from a great philosopher of the Western world, Yogi Berra. It was Yogi Berra who once said, quote, prediction is awfully hard to do, especially if it's about the future. Well, I'm a physicist. We can predict the evolution of the universe billions of years into the future. So let me quote now from that other great philosopher of the Western world, Woody Allen. It was Woody Allen who once said, quote, eternity is an awful long time, especially toward the end. Well, I'm a physicist. We are the ones who invented the laser. We invented the transistor. We helped to assemble the computer and the internet. We wrote the World Wide Web. Along the way, we also invented television. We invented radio, radar, microwave devices, and, as a byproduct, we helped to invent the space program. We created the GPS system and weather satellites. And we physicists love to make predictions. But we helped to assemble the internet. One physicist predicted that the internet would become a forum of high culture, high art, and high society. Well, today we know that 5% of the internet is pornography. But that's because teenage boys log on to the internet. Just wait until the grandmas and grandpas log on to the internet, then 50% of the internet will be pornography. Now, as I said, I had a chance to interview over 300 of the world's top scientists for BBC Television, the Discovery Channel, about the future. But you know, prediction is also dangerous. Let me tell you a story of what happened over 200 years ago in Paris, France, during the great French Revolution. One day there were three gentlemen about to have their heads chopped off at the guillotine. There was a priest, a lawyer, and a theoretical physicist, just like me, about to have our heads chopped off. Well, they put the priest's head on the chopping block, and they asked him, "Do you have any last words before we slice your head off?" And he said, "Yes, yes." He said, God from above shall certainly set me free." Well, all eyes were on the blade. They raised the blade. The blade came down, whoosh, and stopped right before he hit the neck of the priest. Well, the mob had never seen this before, and so the mob said, let him go, because today God has spoken. Now let's see about the lawyer. Yes, the lawyer. They put the lawyer's head in the chopping block, and they asked him, do you have any last words? And he said, yes, maybe the spirit of justice, yes, justice shall set me free. Well, all eyes were on the blade. They raised the blade. The blade came down, whoosh, and stopped right before it hit the neck of the lawyer. Well, this time the mob went crazy, dancing in the streets of Paris. People were saying, today, God has spoken. Justice and mercy have spoken. And now let's see about that theoretical physicist. Well, they put the physicist's head in the chopping block, and they asked him, do you have any last words? And he said, yeah, yeah, I got some last words. And he said, you know, I don't know too much about God, and I know even less about the law, but I do know one thing. If you look up, you'll see that the rope is stuck on the pulley. And then he said, if you remove the rope, the blade should come down real good. Big mistake. Huge, big mistake. Well, the rope came down, the blade came down, and the poor physicist's head came down. And it just goes to show you that sometimes we physicists have to know when to keep our mouths shut. Nonetheless, let us talk about the future and the impact of science on technology. My last book was also a New York Times bestseller. In fact, they tell me that my books are the only time in world history that the word physics ever entered the New York Times bestseller list. Anyway, in the book, Physics of the Impossible, I go 1,000 years into the future when we may have starships, teleportation, maybe even time machines. And I answer the question, what happens if you go backwards in time and meet your teenage mother before you're born and she falls in love with you? Well, if your teenage mother falls in love with you before you're born, you're in deep doo-doo if that happens. But today, let me say a few things about wealth and society. You know, these are hard times. And some people say that we can't afford all this high technology stuff. It's too expensive. What do we get for it? What kind of bang for the buck do we get? Well, let me tell you something. I live in two worlds. In one world, I live in the world of string theory. That's what I do for a living. That's my day job. I work in the 11th dimension, a world of multiple universes. But I also live in a world where we have to pay taxes here on the planet Earth. And these are hard times. But let me tell you something. Science and technology is the engine of prosperity. That's where all this wealth comes from. I'll never forget a story. During the space age, people criticized President LBJ by saying that it costs too much money to build weather satellites. We don't need weather satellites. If you want to know what the weather is, just go outside and put your finger up. We don't need a $1 billion weather satellite program. Well, I still remember watching TV. That very day, the Tyros weather satellite, for the first time in history, was orbiting the Earth and photographed the world's first hurricane from outer space. And as a consequence, the alert went out. We could calculate where the impact site would be. We could calculate probable casualties, property damage. Immediately, the alert went out. And I'll never forget, LBJ, that night, I was watching TV, that night, LBJ said, tonight, the space program has paid for itself. And he was right. And just last week, we had Hurricane Sandy, and a nor'easter that devastated the Northeast. Many of my friends in New York were without power for a week without power. All their food rotting, all their equipment, their supplies, their clothing, their houses washed into the ocean. But supercomputers were able to give us advance warning and could calculate within two hours a time of landfall. But nobody was on TV saying, tonight, ladies and gentlemen, supercomputers have paid for themselves. We have to have a voice. We have to tell the American people that the source of this fantastic wealth comes from science and technology. Let me tell you another story. In 1994, our machine, the Super Collider, was up for grabs in the United States Congress. Our machine was going to put high-energy physics into the map, into the future. But that very day, 1994, they took a vote. The Super Collider was canceled because we physicists had no voice. People were saying, do we really need this gigantic atom smasher? Well, now we have the Large Hadron Collider, a small cousin of the Super Collider now built in Geneva. It's getting all the accolades. The Vatican of physics is no longer in the United States. It's in Geneva, Switzerland. And it's something that we have to take into consideration. We have to have a voice. So let me now talk to you about wealth. Where does wealth come from? Well, first of all, some people say, you can't predict the future. You guys can't even predict the past. Nobody saw the crash of 2008. Well, yes, but that's not quite true. Because where does wealth come from? Ultimately, wealth comes from science and technology. But science and technology come in waves. Waves. One invention, like the steam engine, creates a cascading series of inventions which creates wealth. But wealth is restless. Wealth has to go someplace. And where does wealth go? Into a bubble. And when the bubble pops, you get a depression. So let's talk about physics of 1800. In the last century, physicists worked out the thermodynamics of steam engines. We worked out the Carnot cycle. We gave names to the units of energy and power. We could calculate how many joules of energy you could extract from a steam engine. That gave birth to the locomotive. It gave birth to steel mills and factories, textile mills. All of a sudden, we unleashed the Industrial Revolution, a revolution based on the physics of the thermodynamics of steam engines. But this fantastic wealth had to go someplace. Wealth is restless. And where did wealth go? It went into the London Stock Exchange. Over 200 railroad stocks registered on the London Exchange. It was unsustainable. And what happened? The bubble popped in 1850, creating one of the first greatest crises of capitalism. The crisis was so great that it even gave birth to a philosophy called Marxism. But we physicists are restless. We weren't satisfied with the thermodynamics of steam engines. We wanted to work out electricity and magnetism. Faraday, Maxwell, Edison, they were the ones who pioneered electricity and magnetism, creating the next generation of wealth 80 years later. 80 years later, the next tidal wave of wealth, internal combustion engines, utilities, they dominated the American Stock Exchange of the 1920s. It created a bubble. A huge bubble of wealth. It was unsustainable, and it popped in 1929. 80 years later, on the dot, we physicists unleashed the next wave of wealth and prosperity on the world. High technology, lasers, transistors, computers, the space program, fantastic wealth 80 years later. It created a bubble, a huge bubble in the United States. The bubble went into real estate. In Europe, the bubble went into maintaining the Mediterranean lifestyle. Well, the real estate bubble could not be sustained. Mediterranean lifestyle cannot be sustained. And it created the crash of 2008. So here is the question for today. What is the fourth wave? The wealth of nations, the prosperity of billions rests upon this one question. What is the fourth wave? The first wave was steam power, giving birth to the locomotive, the Industrial Revolution. The second wave was electricity and the automobile, giving birth to the so-called modern age. And then the third wave of wealth was high technology, computers, lasers, the space program. What is the fourth wave? The fourth wave, we think, will be a combination of biotechnology. All medicine is now being digitalized. We'll see that in today's slideshow. Artificial intelligence. Supercomputers are beginning to approach the computational speed of the human mind, but it has a long ways to go before we can create a robot that actually functions and reasons like a human being. And then nanotechnology in the quantum era. Silicon Valley will eventually become a rust belt. The age of silicon will come to a close. No one knows when, 10, 15 years from now, Moore's law is already beginning to slow down nanotechnology may initiate the next revolution beyond silicon. So let's say a few things about Moore's Law. This is Moore's Law, one of the most important laws in modern history. The wealth of nations depends upon this curve, which simply says a computer power doubles every 18 months. Look at this curve. When you get a birthday card in the mail, and it's saying happy birthday to you, there's a chip in it. That chip has more computer power than all the Allied forces of 1945. Stalin, Hitler, Churchill, Roosevelt would have killed to get that chip. And what do you do with that chip? You throw away the garbage. If Hitler had that chip in 1940, we might all be speaking German here today rather than English. And then look at 1969, when we put two men on the moon. Ever see these old videotapes of mission control? Ever see those old clunky computers? Oh my God, they were using 64K processors back in those days. You realize that your cell phone has more computer power than all of NASA in 1969 when they put two men on the moon. I mean, it's criminal. They sent humans into outer space, backed up by a cell phone. You're not gonna get me on those rockets. I'm not gonna go into outer space backed up by one cell phone. But now, look at 2020, and you begin to see something. First of all, a typical chip will cost about a penny in the next 10 years, meaning that computer chips will be everywhere and nowhere, hidden in the fabric of our existence. For example, electricity. Where is electricity today? Electricity is everywhere and nowhere. It's under your feet, in the walls, in the ceiling. And the word electricity has pretty much disappeared from the English language. No one ever says electricity anymore. And look at running water. Running water is under your feet, in the walls, in the ceiling, everywhere and nowhere. And where does electricity come from anyway? You know, the cloud someplace, you know, some power plant someplace. And where does running water come from? You know, the cloud someplace. And when you walk into a room, what's the first thing you do? You look for the light switch. You instinctively look for the light switch. In the future, you will assume walking into a room that computer power is everywhere and nowhere. The word computer will disappear from the English language. And you will pay for computer power the same way you pay for water and electricity. You will meter it. Because high technology is the source of wealth. Look at this map. Where do you see the internet? You see wealth and prosperity. Where you don't, you see ignorance and poverty. And where will the internet be when chips cost a penny? Everywhere and nowhere, including your glasses. These are internet-capable glasses. They actually recognize people's faces. You see a face and it prints out the biography. And if they speak Chinese to you, it'll translate Chinese into English and put subtitles as they speak. How many times have you been at a conference like this and you bump into somebody and you say, who is this person? I know this person. Jim Zhang Jing, who is this person? In the future, the glasses will say, it's Jim, stupid. You see him every year. You want to see his complete biography in your glasses? And let's say you're at a cocktail party and you're looking for a job. And you know there's some heavy hitters there, but you don't know who they are. In the future, you will know exactly who to suck up to at any cocktail party. But maybe you don't want to look like a refugee from Star Trek. Children love this technology. Google Glasses came out just a few months ago. They've been test marketed to kids. Kids are the engine. The Pentagon and children are some of the greatest engines for this fantastic technology. Several ways to do it. You can shoot the image right to the retina of your eye. You can use the lens of your glasses as a screen. Or you can put an eyepiece right on the glasses. Several ways to do it. And eventually, it'll become a fashion statement. When chips cost a penny, the internet will be everywhere and nowhere. Fashion models will wear them. It'll become a fashion statement to be hooked up to the internet everywhere. And when you don't want to be hooked up, you'll simply turn it off. So this is the future of your home office, the future of your home entertainment center, emails, all that just done from the leisure of your sofa. But let's say there's a problem. There's a problem here. Let's say you don't wear glasses. Let's say you don't need glasses. Then what are you going to do? Then you will blink, and you will go online. And who are the first people to buy these internet contact lenses? College students taking final examinations. They'll be the first in line. You simply blink and see all the answers to all the final questions right there. Who's the second person to buy internet contact lenses? President Barack Obama, so he doesn't have to use these damn teleprompters when he gives these speeches. Who's the third person to buy these internet contact lenses? Vice President Biden, so he's always on message. He doesn't deviate too much. Actors, actresses will never flub a line by using these internet contact lenses. Tourists will go through Rome and see the entire Roman Empire resurrected right before your eyes. NASA is interested. Astronauts making repairs in outer space will see blueprints. And if there's a TV camera on the other side shooting the image into your contact lens, you will have X-ray vision. The military is interested in this. The Army has already a working version of this. I'll show you in a minute. The Air Force loves this idea, because if you're in an airplane and you're in a dogfight and the enemy jet goes underneath your jet, you're dead meat. However, you can put a TV camera underneath your jet, shoot the image into your contact lens, and you will have X-ray vision. You will be able to see like Superman right through any object, because there's a camera on the other side shooting the image right into your lens.